then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong. And I grew strong, and I learned how to get along. And so you're back from out of faith. I just walked in to find you here with that sad look upon your face. I should have changed that stupid lock. I should have made you leave your key. If I'd have known for just 1 second you'd be back to bother me. Oh, now go, walk out the door. Just turn around now, cause you're not welcome anymore. Weren't you the one who tried to hurt me with goodbye? You think I'd crumble? You think I'd lay down and die? Oh, no, not I. I will survive. Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know I'll be alive. I've got all my life to live. I've got all my love to give. And I'll survive. I will survive. Hey, hey.
All right, all right, all right. And welcome to Counsel of the Day with Shanrae. And I am Shanrae. Okay. And I want to see if I'm going to look and see if I see any people. I'm working on multiple platforms this evening. So it's so good. I'm trying to see who all's checking in with us. I got to wait for my phone to boot up. But tonight I have a special guest. I have a special guest, and her name is Miss Anika Johnson. Will you please come on in, Anika, and just greet the people? We're so proud to have you on tonight, Miss Anika Johnson.
Hello, everybody. How y'all doing? Glad to be on here tonight with Shanrae. Thank you for the invite. I truly, truly are blessed. Thank you. Hey, y'all.
Yes. We have Miss Anika Johnson with us tonight. Good evening, Charlotte. How are you? It's so good to see you all. I'm going to ask as you come in, please like and share as you make your way in on tonight. Let me know if you can hear me clearly, those that are watching. Okay, so we're on week one, part two of Rejection. Now, Miss Anika is our guest on tonight, and what she's going to be doing is she's going to be giving us a little bit of her personal experience with rejection, and not just only going through it, but how she came through it and overcame it. And so we're going to move on. I want to start with our disclaimer, and then we're going to move on from there. All right.
Please be aware that due to the nature of the technology that I am using, there can be no assurance of confidentiality when using this online service. It should also be noted that due to changes in policies, all replies are to be used as advisory and informational only and will not constitute an official determination. Information provided by myself, other counselors, religious leaders, or people with life experience are subject to the limitations of current and available material, but the final responsibility for successfully achieving a goal rests with you. Information online is designed to be helpful. However, this information does change frequently, and it is recommended that clients or individuals as yourself will consult another physician, another specialist, and or religious leader to aid in your overall behavioral wellness.
All right. So again, tonight's topic is on rejection. We're rejection and why it hurts so much. So I'm going to go on and get and open up and give us just a little bit of brief. And then we're going to, I don't want to delay. I really want you all to hear Miss Anika's, her experience going through. Everybody, listen, rejection, everybody goes through. We know that that's just something that's a part of life. There is no one person in this world that have never experienced rejection. But although we have all experienced rejection, we've all had like unique type of experiences with rejection. And Miss Anika is going to share with us tonight some of the things that she experienced, how she got through it, and now how she's overcome it. So we want to go on and we're going to get started. Y'all know I am a Christian counselor, so I want to go on and start with our, we have a scripture for the month, and my degrees are from Ashford University. I have degrees in psychology, dual degrees, psychology and organizational management. So let's start with our scripture for the month. The first one is Psalms 139 and 13 through 16, the English Standard Version, and it says, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. The second scripture for the month, our sub-scripture, is from Genesis 1, 26th through the 28th verse. And this is from the Message Bible. And it said, God spoke and he said, let us make human beings in our image, make them reflecting our nature. So then God blessed them to prosper, to reproduce, to fill the earth and to take charge. All right. So that is our scripture for the month. And you all know that I do give a definition of the topic that we're talking about. So rejection, I have two from the Webster's Merriam Dictionary. And it says, number one, rejection is defined as the dismissing or refusing of a proposal or an idea, et cetera. Or two, the spurning of a person's affections. So those are the two, those are the two that I chose, definitions for rejection. And again, that comes from the Webster's Merriam Dictionary. Okay, so let's dive into this really, really, really quickly. I'm moving quick because I really do want you all to hear Miss Anika. Again, we're so happy that she's a guest with us on tonight on Counsel Today with Shanrae. All right, so rejection and why it hurts so much. I'm trying to, you know, I'm working my platforms, y'all. I'm working these platforms, so I'm going to move quick. So a psychologist by the name of Mr. Guy Winch, W-I-N-C-H, he shares some practical tips for soothing the sting of rejection. Okay, so rejections are most common, which what I said earlier, common emotional wounds that everybody sustains in daily life. Our risk of rejection used to be limited by the size of our immediate social circle or our dating pools. But today, thanks to electronic communication, social media platforms, and dating apps, each of us are connected to thousands of people, any of whom might ignore our posts or our chats, texts, or whatever like that. But in addition to this type of rejections, those were considered minor rejections because it's not close and personal. We're still vulnerable to like more serious devastations of rejections as well, like our spouse leaving us, when we get fired from a job, snubbed by our friends or ostracized by our families and communities for our lifestyle choices. The pain that we may feel can absolutely be paralyzing. So whether the rejection that we experience is large or small, one thing always remains constant, and that it always hurts, and it usually hurts more than what we expect. So the question again is, why are we so bothered by maybe a good friend failing to like our family holiday pictures that we might have posted on Facebook? Or and I'm gonna pause there. There's a movie, remember, there's an old school movie called Vacation, European Vacation. They had Christmas Vacation with Chevy Chase and his wife and his two kids. Then they had, they just did a modern version of Vacation with, it's a newer actor by the name of Price. I cannot remember his first name, but this man was also in the movies. It was a sequel of the movie, not The Bachelor. But if you watch the new modern version of Vacation, his wife, it's a scene in there where his wife was talking to their neighbor, and the neighbor had said to his wife, you know, I see that you was looking at my post on Facebook, but you didn't like none of them. So at the end of that evening, they were having dinner together. Like, you know, neighbors were having dinner together. So at the end of the that night when they was in the bed, she and her husband, she was on Facebook liking every post her neighbor put on there because she didn't want any animosity between them. So this is how serious it's become with like rejection, even social media. So we said again, the question again is why? Why are we so bothered by people, good friends, failing to like our posts? Why does it ruin our mood? Would something so seemingly insignificant makes us feel angry at our friends, moody and bad about ourselves? So the greatest damage rejection caused usually is self-inflicted. We're going to get into that. But let me give you a quick answer. So the answer is our brains are really wired to respond this way. And it goes back to, and this is theory tested. It goes back to when when we were first settlers and stuff like that, living years and years ago when people were living in tribes, and even if you think about in the Bible, where if someone was ostracized from their tribe, they would, you know, people would die because they would be alone. They would be isolated. Even in the Bible, when they put people out, you know, and so they didn't last. They didn't live long because they were not a part of a society. So this is where our brains are wired, but we're actually wired to want to be loved, to be around stuff. So let's move on. This now we know why we feel why rejection hurts us so much. I want Miss Anika to give us a little bit of her testimony, and then I'm going to be asking certain questions and giving certain points in the middle of this. But Miss Anika, would you please share some of your experience about a rejection with the audience?
Yes. Once again, I'd like to say thank you for inviting me for this platform. Actually, mine started when I was young. I was 2 years old. That's when it actually started, you know, just being a girl, looking for a certain attention, you know, from my father, and I wasn't able to get it, you know, and it was like, you know, why? So mine actually went from 2 years till I was about 35. Dealing with it, you know, wanted to know, tried to reach out, tried to ask questions, and I never could get the answer from him. He was in the service. So during that time from me between two up until, I guess about maybe my late 20s, I think he finally got out of the service, but it still wasn't no connection there at all. And I would look and look. I knew who he was, but I couldn't find out why or get the reason why he wasn't there until I became 35 years old. So, and that's when I got the answer.
Okay, so how were you able to... No, I'm going to back up before this. Can okay. you explain some of the emotions and some of the feelings you had from 2 to 5 as far as feeling rejected? And I'm talking about from your personal experience, because those viewers that are watching, they may say, oh, well, that's a no. Everybody will experience the same feelings. That's not true. Each person is different. Can you give us some of the feelings that you had? Like, give us stages when you turned 10, when you turned 16, major parts, when you turned 21, you know, what like that, when you became a parent. So can you give us some examples?
I can. Actually, I had a lot of anger. I was mad all the time because I was the one that was always reaching out to his family members from 2 to maybe, and it's crazy because from 2 years old to 6 years old, maybe 7 years old, I was small, but I was always looking for him. I always knew something like wasn't right. You know what I'm saying? How can I be a child of somebody and I don't have any connection? And it bothered me. Now, I saw him at 2, but the next time I saw him, and I know you're asking me, I was angry. I was an angry child from 2 up until maybe 19. And that's when I saw him at 19. But I only saw him. We only came together at the age of 19 is because I had 2 uncles that got killed at the same time. So they was buried at the same time.
Wow.
Yes. Wow. So from 2 to 6 and 9, my mom, them, you know, I would talk to my aunts and I always say, well, where is he? And they was like, oh, well, you know, he's in the service. And nobody would give me an answer. I didn't have no phone calls, but I was mad because I was like, well, I can't give an answer from nobody, right. Nobody, right. No adult. So I was bitter from 2 up until 19, still bitter, you know, got into, you know, trouble, and not major trouble, but just trouble where I would fight.
Right.
You know, yeah. I would fight and be mad, but nobody knew why I was mad because I didn't share it. But I was always searching for an answer. And I would go and spend time with my family, my aunts and uncles. But guess what? It wasn't like they knew I even existed, because it was just like, oh, hey, how you doing? You can come over. You can talk this and that. We can have fun and this and that. And it was like, okay, I can go on about my business. So it wasn't a close-knit relationship due to me not being, I guess, in his space. Right. And he wasn't around. So from 2 to 19, it was 17 years of that that I didn't see him until something tragic happened.
And see, that's even anger is a part of, I'm going to, let me show the next slide. Anger is a part of self-infliction too when it comes to neglect. I want to read read a little bit about that. And it really mostly talks about being self-critical and everything like that. But I'm going to highlight on anger myself, which is a part, again, a part of self-inflictions. When you're angry, when you have anger inside of you, a lot of times you push people away, people that genuinely care about you, you push people away because of that anger. A lot of times, like you said, you may know to some extent why you're angry, but you may not know fully why. And you were trying that void. You have been trying to reach out to the family and try to, you know, become a part of your paternal side of the family. And unfortunately, there was rejection even with them because, like you said, because you didn't grow up around them. So it was more like a casual, hey, how you doing? Rather than this is my niece, this is my grandchild, and that love there. So it was like a double and triple and quadruple dose of that. And so anger, and like you said, it that anger, that fuel, that angry fuel, it just have you lashing out at anybody. And a lot of times we're the ones that's wrong. The ones that are angry, we're the ones that's wrong, picking fights with people. And that's self-infliction, because who I want to be around an angry person all the time? You know, really. And then, and then you can't even stand your own self. To be truthful, when you really to sit there and think about it, you can't even stand your own self because of that anger. And then you have to try to find a way to rehabilitate. And if you do not, if you don't know how to, or even have the finances or have the medical insurance to go and sit down and speak with a counselor, then you have to find ways yourself to self-heal and to self, do self-therapy so you can get past this. Now, one of the things I want to come in on is, did you ever criticize your own self due to this?
Of course, because I always had that why. I always wanted to know why. I always wanted to know where he was. I always wanted to know why you didn't want to have a relationship with me. You understand? What did I do? Did I do anything? You know, why? I'm your daughter. So why do you and I don't have a relationship? And then as I got older, you know, found out he was married and he had other kids. So it was like, oh, really? You know, so... I wanted to know. And when you can't get an answer, and like I said, being young from 2 up until, you know, a teenager, you know, I didn't pick fights with people because I always isolated myself, because I was always kind of person that I stuck to myself. I had associates, but still, I kept people at a distance. You know, so I didn't allow people to get in my space. Then when you got in my space, that's where the anger came in, you know, because if you said something that I didn't like, and it probably wasn't how, you know, you didn't mean it that way. But yeah, I had the, you know, the anger. And the anger was not like I was just always just mad, but I was just always quiet. I would have moments where I'm having a good time, but then I would have moments where it's like, okay. I see my aunts and my uncles, and it's like, okay, have y'all talked to them? They'd be like, well, no, you know, he was not in communication with them either, but still, you know, as a child or as a teenager, still like, well, why y'all didn't ask him, or why y'all don't know want to deal with me, or y'all adults, y'all supposed to tell me, and we haven't talked to him either, that's just him. No, that to me, those was excuses. That's how I felt, because like I said, I was from 2 up until, you know, the next time I saw him, and even when I saw him then, it was the wrong time. wrong place. I didn't even try to get the answer.
Right.
Because it was, he was grieving, you know what I'm saying? So why try to worry about an answer then? I would get it later. At least that's what I was telling myself.
Right,
you know?
Right.
At that moment, I was just happy to see him and to see.
Yes.
You know, if
who,
we can.
Who, the other part, that the other part of you, because that's the, where you came from, of course. But I experienced, I was singing at a funeral. I was asked to sing at a funeral because I am a singer. Y'all know that. And it was like for a family member who's married into the family. So it's their side of the family. So I was not familiar with that family there. But it was a family member of mine who married into my family. And it was their side of the family, if you can follow me. And so while we were there, one of my little, one of my relatives, I noticed that, you know, they're a musician. I noticed that they were kind of, they seemed like something was wrong. And because their mannerism, their demeanor was really, really off. They were like really distracted. So after the funeral, he came over and said, "Auntie, I just found out that that's my real daddy right now." And this is a grown man. He was 25. "To Auntie, I just found out that's my real daddy." Now he was raised by his auntie and uncle, really are his mother and father because they raised him from birth. But he always knew who his biological mother was, but he never knew his biological father was. And somebody came and told him before the funeral, "That's your real daddy right there," and it just. Off. He was 25. This threw him, but it hurt. You could see it. It hurt. So you know that's some. I want to ask, what did you do from that time on to revive your self worth?
From what? From 19 up until 35.
Yes. When you saw him, how did you revive your self worth?
At that moment. I didn't because I was still mad, but it wasn't the time and the place to speak on it. You know, he tried to give me bits and bits of pieces why he wasn't there. But to me, it was just like going in one ear and not the other. Like, to me, that's not an excuse. You're a grown man. You decide to have a child. And what you're trying to tell me is that it was irrelevant at that time. Right. So I was still mad. And so I didn't want to hear the reason because I felt like the reason that he was telling me, it wasn't a legit reason because, like I said, I was your child.
Right.
So the next time you physically saw me again, well, per my family, he saw me again when I was 7 when my grandmother passed away. But I don't recall that. I only recall seeing him the last time I saw him when I was 2. So the next time I see you again, I'm 19.
Right.
So it's nothing you can tell me at this point. You understand what I'm saying? Like, what can you tell me from birth, whatever, up until 19, that the reason why you couldn't be involved with me is because you was overseas or whatever? That's more of a reason why I feel like you should have been more involved.
Right.
Because you're overseas, you're in the service.
Right.
You should have been, you know, there.
Right.
But, I guess he had his moments or his reasons. I still didn't get the answers. So I only became, I guess I kind of started dealing with it and accepting it when I maybe got 23.
Right, okay.
And at that point, when I got 23, I had spoken to a friend. And the friend, you know, we kind of had a conversation. She was like, "Oh, well, you know, I don't even know who mine is." I was like, whoa.
Okay. Yes.
You know? So I'm not as bad as I thought I was.
Right.
At least I have an idea of who mine is. And
right.
I just seen him a few years ago. So it was like, okay, you know, just kind of, now I'm not going to say let it go,
right.
But it wasn't hurting me as bad as it was up until when I saw him when I was 19. So at the age of 23, I was kind of like, okay, it is what it is. It's his loss.
Right.
It ain't mine anymore.
And that was the process of you reviving yourself. Okay.
Yes.
Right. I have on the screen, if you all can see it, it says emotional pain. So pain in this life is not avoidable, but the pain that we create avoiding pain is avoidable. I'm gonna say that again because it's like a tongue twister. So it says for emotional pain, because that's emotional pain that you experience. That's emotional pain that I was telling you about my nephew, that was emotionally painful for him. So it says emotional pain. Pain in this life is not avoidable, but the pain that we create avoiding pain, is avoidable. And that's by R.D. Lang, who is an M.D. I want to talk about some useful ways to reboot our emotional health. Some useful ways to reboot our emotional health. I think that's what it says. Let me, because y'all know I'm working these multiples. Okay. So number one, it talks about number one says that we are going to pay attention. I'm sorry. I'm hearing something in the background. All right. Number one says to pay attention to your emotional pain, recognize it when it happens, and work to treat it before it feels all encompassing. All right. And then number two says to redirect our gut reaction when we feel like that we failed. So I'm going to go back and ask Anika both of these at the same time. Number one, you were paying attention to your emotional pain. Recognize when it happens and work to treat. You just said at 23, I mean, you recognized early when it was happening to you and to treat it. What did you do to start treating your feelings of rejection?
I just stopped blaming myself. I just started telling myself, you know, I cannot be the reason, you know.
Right.
Stop saying you're not worthy or he didn't want you. I didn't know. I just didn't know. But what I did was I just stopped saying, okay, you did push him away or, you know, because those was my thoughts between two up until that age. Like, what did I do? You know, what did I do to him for him not to want to be a part of my life? Or what happened? Those was my always question. What happened? Nobody could ever give me an answer. Or then I just stopped. So at that time, like I said, at the age of 23, you know, I was just, when I spoke to a certain person, she was like, well, I ain't never seen mine. So I was just like, okay,
so,
let me stop
beating
myself up because, okay, if she ain't never seen hers, don't even have an idea of what hers look like, I do. I know what mine look like.
Right.
But I'm better. I'm good.
Right.
My mom raised me.
Yeah.
I'm not a lost child. You know,
right.
I did good. So that was his loss. And that's how I started looking at it every day, telling myself, just let it go, let it go. And it's kind of hard.
Right.
It's kind of
hard.
Right. But I was telling. And then sometimes you got to move yourself out of a certain situation, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because I was in another state. So when it was like when my mom took me from one state to another state, it was just like, woof, because I didn't have to worry about seeing the other side of the family.
Okay, you know, yes,
so
yes.
It was just like, ooh, that helped me because now I ain't got to worry about seeing them. I ain't got to try, you know, even though I tried to reach out to them because
right.
that's my side of the family.
Right.
But seeing them and being in the same city or same town, I didn't have to worry about that no more. So it felt good because my mom was like, I don't, you know, if it had not been for my mom taking me from one state to another state, it probably would have kept on bothering me even more.
Right.
Or maybe to a point where, you know, something else would have probably took place. But
right.
my healing actually started when my mom took me from one state to another state.
Okay, so like the screen is what I'm showing, the PowerPoint, it says to redirect your gut reaction when you feel like that you fail or you have any kind of feelings of failure. And it says change your mind, change your mood, and change your heart. And that's what it sounds like you did. And like you said, it also helped that your mother changed locations. So that really
yes.
helped you.
Yes. Because I was, like I said, I was angry. I was mad and I wanted to know why. And you know, back then we was always taught what goes on stays where you
right,
know,
right, yeah.
Our people didn't tell us.
Right.
You know.
Right.
So
right.
me coming as a child, who am I ask? I want to ask. They're not going to tell me the truth. Right. You know, they should have, but they didn't.
But you know, that was a different era. Now everything is that open. You know, they we gonna get to the bottom of this, and it's that exposure era and stuff like that. And so, but back then, you're right, and that was with all cultures where you know what happens here stays here, and our family is nobody's business, whatever. And you'll be all right. You'll be all right. You know how it is. You'll be all right. You'll live. You know that old saying. Yeah. You'll live. So number three says to monitor and protect your self-esteem. When you feel like putting yourself down, take a moment to be compassionate to your own self. Take a moment to be compassionate. I'm going to put this over here because I want them to see about monitoring and protecting your self-esteem. And I liked how you actually took someone else's experience. You're like, man, at least I know who my father is. At least I seen him. And you were able to meet someone who didn't, they just never had a clue. And they seem to be okay, you know, because again, we can't control other people's actions. We may, especially our parents, if we may want them to be a good parent, or we want them to be an available parent, but that's not the case all of the time with people. Like on here, when it says monitor and protect yourself. So to feel compassion for others, it starts with feeling compassion for you, as this says right here. You got to start to feel compassion for yourself. And so I'm going to... So when you started having those negative thoughts taking over, how did you disrupt them with positive distractions? With a positive distraction, how did you do that? How did you disrupt your negative thoughts, your negative feelings? What positive thing did you do to change that?
My kids. My kids, because it was like, I'm not gonna be that parent. You know, I'm going to be in my kids. I'm going to be here with my kids. And my kids was the one who changed my perspective. I didn't, you know, I held them close. I was maybe came overprotected, but it didn't matter. But they're my children. And that's what my kids was the one who changed my thought pattern. Made me feel like, okay, you got kids now. So now you have to be here for your kids. And was it easy? No, not at all. Because still, you still got to remember from 20-some up until 35, that thought still came across my mind. I still wanted to know that why. And I still didn't get that why until I turned 35.
Right.
But I still didn't let it get me down at the times that I did when I was coming from younger up until I got 19.
Right. And like this is saying here, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you. It sounds like you found meaning in your loss. Like it was still considered, you know, sometimes we still consider things a loss. But you changed that dynamic, because what I'm getting from what you're just saying is that you actually stepped up to be the parent that you didn't have. So you was that available parent for your children, which you found meaning in the loss on that end with you. And so you stepped up to be that available parent to your children, which to me, you found a great meaning in what you didn't have, you provided. Okay. Yes. That's a sermon right there. What you didn't have, you provided. Yes. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Yes, God is real. Hallelujah. And he's real in our souls. What you didn't have, you provided. You found that meaning in loss. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Uh-huh. So it sounds like, because I'm moving quick. So you didn't let that guilt anymore. You didn't let that guilt hold you down.
I didn't let it hold me down, but like I said, it was that question was still there. And then at 35, once I got the answer, I put two and two together and I was like, oh, okay. It is what it is. And, you know, I didn't worry about it no more. And now the crazy thing about it is that, you know, over the years after that, it was just like, okay, it is what it is. I didn't search. I didn't do anything. I didn't worry about it. Up until 2016, I was getting certain phone calls or whatever that he had them took ill. And then 2017, he passed away. Yeah, so.
But it didn't come from the source. That source.
It didn't.
But you got your answer from, you got from a source.
I got my answer from a source, yes.
And it sounded like that void was filled after that because you got the answers that you were seeking.
Of course. Once I got the answer at the age of 35, God just completely, when I tell you, just took it away. He completely took it away. I didn't question it anymore. I didn't worry about it anymore. I didn't even want to know anymore because, like I said, I was always trying to get the answer from him. But God would never allow me to get the answer from him. He would, and I would be trying and trying, and right. He wouldn't. So he allowed a reliable source to tell me. And once I received that information, I was like, wow, okay, it is what it is. That was his loss. It's not my loss anymore. So I'm going to move on.
Say that again. Say that. Whose loss was it for real?
It was his loss. It wasn't my loss anymore. And I don't have to worry about it. Like I said, 16, I got the news, heard he was sick. And I was like, you know what, Lord? You done gave me peace up until now. Now because then I was like, okay, I was still kind of trying to want to, you know, reach out and maybe talk to him just to find out a little bit more. But when I tell you, God still didn't allow me to get nowhere near, don't try to find out. He didn't allow me to do it. So then I just started asking him. I said, well, if you don't want me to, you know from him, which I already knew, mm-hmm. but I wanted to know from him. And he right. wouldn't let me know from him. So I said, well, just give me a peace of mind because now he's sick. So I can't worry about that. That's between you and him now. And he started easing my mind as the year went by of 2016. And then 2017 came along and he passed away. And I was able to be there at the funeral. And it felt good.
Right.
You know, it felt good to able to just see him at peace. Whatever what was going on, whatever he didn't do or he did do, it didn't matter anymore. He right. was at peace. So right. I left it at that.
So on the screen, it says here that learn what treatments for emotional wounds work for you. And you said something that was very, very, very transparent. You said through the Lord helped you to understand and accept, what you experienced in your lifetime with your father, and which therefore you experienced peace behind that. You experienced peace behind that. So these are three things right here. I'm sorry. Like I said, I'm working multiple platforms, but these are three things that can help you. Three treatments that can help you with emotional wounds that maybe one of them may work. Maybe all three of them may work. But number one is have zero tolerance for self-criticism. Zero. I'm sorry. There we go. Zero. Have zero tolerance for self-criticism. That's number one. Number two is revive your self-worth. Number three is boost feelings of social connection. So if you can reconnect with some people, go to line dancing class. Meet people there. Reconnect. You know, church is always a great social avenue for people to meet up. There's different things. There's people that are in the arts, you know, but those are three things that that can help you. I'm going to give a takeaway because our time is up. We're on a little bit longer tonight because of our wonderful guest, Miss Anika Johnson, and I'm probably going to bring her back later on in the year to talk about some other topics. This is all practicing emotional hygiene. And it takes a little time and effort, but it will seriously elevate your entire quality of life. If you start to zone in on these things that we talked about on tonight, these strategies. So our takeaway for this evening is, how can you combat the lies that threaten to steal your joy? So you're going to seek the truth found in scripture. Again, I am a Christian counselor, so I believe on standing on Christian values and the word of God. And this really does work. So your identity as a follower of Christ, or your identity period, is it found in what you can do or what you have failed to do? Let me say that again. Your identity as a Christian follower or your identity as a person, period, is not found in what you can do or what you failed to do. You're a Christian, a word that literally means little Christ. And your identity is in whose, W-H-O-S-E, whose you are. So when people leave you or disappoint you, and this was very disappointing, but as you can see, Miss Anika Johnson is what? That's right. She good. She, you know, when you look at her, you see a vibrance on her. There's a glow to her. She's not walking around morbid and angry and anything like that, sarcastic, unapproachable. She's not like that. What you see is joy. You see happiness. And so when people leave you or disappoint you and you feel abandoned and unwanted, read 1 Peter 2 and 9. And this will remind you that as a Christian or as a person, period, that we are a chosen people. And that God wants you, and he's placed people here on this planet that I want you to, all right? So, Miss Anika, would you please tell everybody who you are and what you do, up and rising counselor herself, please let everybody know how they can find you on social media.
Well, you can reach out to me on social media. You can find me as Anika Johnson. I am on Facebook, or you can find me up under my page. I am a certified life coach, Anika Life Coach. You can find me there. But just look out. You're going to see some changes and some new things that God has given to me that he would like for me to do. So just watch out for me. You'll see me in the future. Thank you all for allow me to be on this platform. I truly, 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 truly appreciate it.
Thank you for being my guest today on Counsel of the Day with Shanrae. I want to leave y'all with this. Resetting your thinking with the truth of God's word is a crucial step in living beyond happiness and dwelling in your identity in Christ. So step into the joy you have as God's beloved child. All right, so I'm gonna put on here, and you know, I am a one-on-one counselor. Shanrae Price is a one-on-one counselor. So if you're interested in a professional one-on-one counseling service, feel free to contact me via Facebook Messenger or at ShanraeCherieProce@gmail.com. I'm a lifestyle strategist, and my aim is to aid you in your life's goals and your life's dreams. Also, I have to do this. And if you feel led, then praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay, so if you feel that this teaching has helped you in a positive way or blessed your life, please feel free to donate a coffee blessing, because those that know I'm a Starbucks girl. So please feel free to donate a coffee blessing to my Cash App, which is $ Shanrae Cherie Price. And our time is up. Thank you again, Miss Anika, for all that you have done, for being on our platform this evening. We will be inviting you again this year. God bless you. And bless you everything that you're going to do this year, it's going to soar by leaps and bounds. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. And we're going to put on our outro music.